Black Ops 6 is the latest installment in the long-running Call of Duty series, and it also happens to be the first Call of Duty game I'm covering on this channel. And despite the absence of ray tracing this time around, Black Ops 6 still manages to deliver the level of realism and detail we've come to expect from the franchise. The pre-baked lighting in particular looks stunning, with most scenes showing minimal light leakage or a natural glow, especially indoors or in low light conditions. Visual effects like fire, smoke, and particles also look impressive, and everything combined with the high quality assets and environmental details contributes significantly to the game's cinematic quality. But not everything is perfect, and there are some visual flaws and issues, such as the major LOD pop-in that can be noticeable and distracting. In addition to some other visual bugs like the noisy and grainy screen space elements, along with some inconsistencies in the witness shaders and effects. And on the performance side, despite not using ray tracing, Black Ops 6 is quite demanding. But thankfully, the game features a robust graphics menu with a wide range of settings and upscaling options. So as usual, we're going to take an in-depth look at these graphics settings, examine the performance and visual impact of each one to achieve high performance levels without significantly compromising the visual fidelity. Just a quick disclaimer before we start, I'll be testing these settings primarily in the campaign, because testing in competitive multiplayer matches is challenging for obvious reasons. However, in the comparison between optimized settings and extreme preset at the end of the video, I'll use the benchmark tool, which is representative of the performance in multiplayer matches. Additionally, my recommendations for each setting will focus on balancing performance and visuals, so this isn't about lowering everything for maximum frame rates. But if that's what you're after, this video should give you insight into settings that might impact both visibility and performance in competitive matches. So with that out of the way, let's get going.
Just like that, huh? Just like that.
Let's start by examining the upscaling and image quality options. The game features a variety of options, but I'll focus on the four main ones: DLSS, FSR3, XeSS, and FidelityFX CES, which is similar to native or the off option, but with added CES sharpening for extra clarity. Now, testing these options at 1440p in quality mode shows that DLSS nearly matches the native CES option. In fact, it does a better job at handling the noise on some transparent surfaces, such as the rear window of this car. XeSS also performs well, though it looks softer compared to the other options. When it comes to FSR3, however, there is a significant shimmering on foliage, and I suspect there may be an issue with FSR3's implementation in this game, at least at 1440p. Because here, even FSR1 appears more stable and handles these trees better than FSR3, which is something that shouldn't be possible. Now, in terms of performance, at least on my system with the 5700X3D and 3060 Ti, XeSS and FSR3 perform similarly, with DLSS having a slight edge. And at native resolution, we can see again that DLSS or DLAA runs better. But here the CES option is ahead, and remember, I am not using the variable rate shading. This is true native resolution. And speaking of variable rate shading, let's examine this setting and see how it affects the visuals and performance. Now, variable rate shading, or VRS, is a technique designed to boost performance by allowing different parts of the frame to be shaded at different rates. We can see this clearly here in this example, where enabling VRS has a minor impact on image quality at the center of the frame. But if we take a look at the edges or the corners, the quality loss is more pronounced, and the performance benefits of VRS vary depending on the scene. Here, there is around 16% performance gain when enabling VRS with minimal impact on image quality. But here in the previous area, where the impact is more noticeable, the performance gain is much larger, with around 37%. So for image quality, if you have an RTX GPU, I recommend sticking with DLSS upscaling. Otherwise, FidelityFX CES with variable rate shading is a great way to achieve high performance with fewer artifacts and less softness than FSR3 or XeSS. Let's move on to details and textures, starting with texture resolution. This one, as its name indicates, adjusts the resolution of textures. And here the texture quality takes a big hit when going below normal. And there is around 4-5% performance cost when using normal or high. In terms of VRAM, I tested the game with high textures at native 1440p on the 8GB RTX 3060 Ti. And it runs smoothly, at least on this mission, with stable performance and no noticeable issues. But I observed some problems in the graphics menu when switching some settings. Like here, when moving from DLAA to Fidelity FX-CES, there is a temporary performance drop and an increase in the RAM usage, which suggests a VRAM limitation. Additionally, when using the same settings on both the RTX 3060 Ti and the 4070 Super, I noticed that the RAM usage was higher with the 8GB GPU, while the VRAM usage on the 4070 Super exceeded 8GB. This indicates that with the RTX 3060 Ti, some data is offloaded to system RAM, which could cause performance drops or stuttering in more demanding areas or missions. So I recommend playing it safe and use normal textures if you have an 8GB GPU. Moving on to texture filter anisotropic. This one adjusts the clarity of distant textures when viewed from an oblique angle, as you can see here. And as usual, this setting does not have any significant performance impact. Therefore, I recommend keeping it at ultra. Black Ops 6 makes extensive use of the depth of field effect, especially in cutscenes and conversations, as shown here, where enabling it has a negligible performance impact. This effect also appears during regular gameplay, like when aiming, with only around 3% performance cost, or here underwater, where the performance impact remains minimal. So if you like this effect, you can keep it enabled without worrying about the performance. Next we have detail quality. This one controls the level of detail and mesh complexity for most 3D objects in the scene. For instance, here we can see how low and normal look pretty much identical, but switching to high improves the polygonal density of most objects. In terms of performance, there is around 3% cost when going from low and normal to high, so here I recommend high. Particle resolution adjusts the resolution of particle effects such as fire, smoke, dust, etc. And we can see this here. Notice how the fire looks pixelated when using anything below high. In terms of performance, from very low to normal, there is no difference, but going to high costs around 12%. However, if we take a look at another example where the particles are close to the camera, like here, high particle resolution causes a significant drop of around 26%. So here I recommend keeping particle resolution at normal. Next is bullet impacts, which simply determines whether or not bullet decals are displayed on surfaces. And this setting can provide an advantage in multiplayer matches, as seeing these decals can indicate where recent firefights have occurred. In terms of performance, this setting has no impact. Therefore, I recommend keeping it enabled. Persistent effects is quite similar to the previous setting, but instead of decals, it should control the quality of effects that linger or persist after an explosion, like debris, dust, smoke, etc. But here in Black Ops 6, I found it difficult to notice any visual difference when toggling this setting, and there is no performance impact, at least in this example. So if you are noticing performance drops during or after explosions, turn this off. Otherwise, feel free to keep it enabled. Shader quality is one of the most crucial and demanding settings in this game. It affects the quality of the lighting and how light interacts with various surfaces. Like here, notice how switching from low to medium enables reflections and introduces contact hardening shadows, where shadows cast by distant objects appear more diffused unlike low, which produces uniformly sharp and alias shadows. Moving up to high drastically alters the look of the scene, making it darker, with more accurate shading on foliage and most other surfaces. And as mentioned earlier, shader quality is a performance intensive setting. Here, going from low to medium costs around 25% and to high around 39%. So for this one, I recommend medium, but low is still a good option for competitive settings. On-demand texture streaming is an option that allows the game to download surface textures in real time. And using minimal, as you can see here, can lead to low resolution textures even if the texture resolution setting is set to high. And generally, this will have an impact on your internet connection more than the in-game performance. So if you have a slow internet connection, you might need to keep this at minimal to avoid any issues or lag when playing online. The last setting in this section is local texture streaming quality, and the exact function of this setting is somewhat unclear. According to the menu description, it should adjust the quality of distant zones for large maps, which suggests it might affect distant textures or LODs. But here we can see the same texture quality and LOD pop in between low and normal, and this setting has no significant performance impact, at least on this map, so I recommend leaving it at normal. Let's move on to shadow and lighting, starting with shadow quality. This setting controls the resolution of both local shadows from artificial lights and cascaded shadows from the sun and the moon, as you can see here. And visually speaking, starting from normal, we can notice more coherent shadows, unlike very low and low. Performance wise, going from very low and low to normal and high costs around 4-5%, and to ultra around 9%. So for this one, I recommend normal. Next we have screen space shadows. These shadows are used to add contact shadows for weapons and other small environmental details. And visually there is no noticeable difference between low and high. Performance wise, this setting has negligible impact, therefore I recommend keeping it at high. Moving on to occlusion and screen space lighting. This setting determines the method used for ambient occlusion and lighting. And here when switching between the options, we see minor differences in ambient occlusion quality from low to high, with ultra offering a slight improvement in coverage and accuracy. In terms of performance, there is around 2% when going from off to low, 3% to medium and high, and 5% to ultra. So given that the difference between low and ultra is so subtle and hard to notice during regular gameplay, I recommend keeping this one at low. Next we have screen space reflections. As I mentioned in the intro, the game struggles with screen space elements. Here we can see how noisy both screen space reflections and shadows look when using upscaling. DLSS manages this noise better than the other options, but still imperfect. Additionally, when using SSR, I noticed a lot of visual glitches, particularly on some water surfaces, as you can see here. And even with all these issues, SSR in this game is a little bit heavy, especially at higher resolution. Here when using DLSS, going from off to normal and high costs around 5%. However, when using DLAA, this cost increases to about 9%. So because of all these issues, I recommend keeping screen space reflections disabled for now. Static reflection quality controls the quality of cube map reflections, which serve as a fallback for SSR and also used on some surfaces like glass, mirrors, and vehicle bodies. And these reflections have no significant impact on performance, so I recommend keeping this setting at high. Let's move on to the final section, environment, starting with tessellation. This setting should adjust mesh detail, adding bumpiness and depth to the terrain and certain surfaces. However, after testing multiple scenes and restarting the game, I could not observe any noticeable difference in visuals or performance. So maybe I am looking in the wrong spots, or this setting might be broken for now. Either way, tessellation shouldn't have a significant performance impact on modern GPUs, so I recommend keeping this one at least at near. Volumetric quality adjusts the resolution of volumetric effects and lighting, and moving from low to medium and to high reduces flickering and breakups in these effects, as you can see here. Additionally, in some areas, this setting has an impact on the density or thickness of volumetric fog. Performance wise, going from low to medium costs around 2% and to high 7%. However, in scenes with more volumetric effects, such as this one, the jump from low to high can have a larger impact, around 19%. Therefore, I recommend keeping volumetric quality at low or medium. The third physics quality controls the quality and accuracy of the formation physics on water and deformable terrains. Like here, notice how a wave appears in front of the character as he swims when using low or high. However, even with high, there is a noticeable flickering. And in terms of performance, enabling this setting has no significant impact. But because of the flickering problem, I recommend leaving this one disabled. Weather grid volumes is another setting with an unclear exact function. According to the menu description, this setting should adjust the quality of weather effects applied to dynamic objects, like characters. But here when comparing off and ultra, we can see no noticeable difference. Even with this setting turned off, this character still has weather effects applied to him. Additionally, there is a slight performance gain when using off. Therefore, I recommend keeping this one disabled. Water quality controls two main water effects. The first is water caustics, which simulates light patterns created by reflection and refraction of light rays on water surfaces. And performance-wise, water caustics has a small impact, around 2%. The second effect is water wetness, which also has a minimal performance impact. However, in some instances such as here, this effect can lead to noticeable flickering and visual issues. So for this one, I recommend water caustics. Before wrapping this section up, let's take a look at some personal preference settings, starting with field of view. In this game, I noticed that increasing the FOV tends to improve performance, as we can see here, and I believe this is due to the game's subpar LOD system, as at narrower FOVs, some distant objects are rendered with higher details, such as these cycads. Finally, let's examine motion blur. Now, in this game, there are two toggles for motion blur. The first is world motion blur, which enables camera motion blur, and it doesn't have any performance impact, as you can see here. The second is weapon motion blur, which enables per object motion blur on weapons, and similar to the previous one, it doesn't have any significant performance impact. So given everything we've discussed, here are my recommended settings for Call of Duty Black Ops 6. Let's compare the performance of optimized settings and extreme preset at 1440p using FidelityFX CES with variable rate shading enabled. And here we can see on average around 44% performance improvement when going from extreme preset to optimized quality, and 66% when using optimized performance. And with that, we arrive at the end. Thank you so much for watching and for your time. If you enjoyed the video, leave a like, and if not, leave a dislike. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell for future videos, and hopefully I'll see you all in the next one.